Hello, everyone. Thanks for being here. I'm Melissa Kane. I'm a politics reporter for KPIX Channel 5. So we're here today. We're going to talk about the new book, How the Hell Did This Happen? A remarkably accurate description of how so many are feeling. I went to Amazon.com and read some of the book reviews. And one of them said, I recommend this book to anyone who wakes up every morning not knowing whether to laugh or cry. Maybe some of you are in the audience today, so you're in the right place. We're going to have some fun. So the way this is going to work is I'm going to give an introduction for Mr. O'Rourke, although he does not need one. You're going to get one. And then he's going to speak for about 20 minutes, and then after that, we'll have Q&A for about 40 minutes. So be sure and send those questions up on your cards. We'll try to work those into the Q&A session. So the way we start, for sort of official purposes, I get to bang the gavel 3 times. It's so much fun. And then it's as fun as it looks. And then we'll sort of launch right into the sort of audio portion of the program. Does anyone have any questions about how things are going to go here? All righty, cool. Let's get started. Good evening and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. You can find us online at commonwealthclub.org, on Facebook and Twitter, and on the club's YouTube channel. I'm Melissa Kane. I'm a politics reporter for CBS 5 Television in San Francisco and your moderator. And it is my pleasure to introduce today's distinguished speaker, P.J. O'Rourke. He's a celebrated political satirist, an H.L. Mencken Research Fellow at the Cato Institute, and the author of this new book, How the Hell Did This Happen? The Election of 2016. P.J. O'Rourke was born and raised in Toledo, Ohio, and attended Miami University and Johns Hopkins. He began writing funny things in the 60s in underground newspapers and became the editor-in-chief of the National Lampoon, then spent 20 years reporting for Rolling Stone and the Atlantic Monthly as the world's only trouble spot humorist, going to wars, riots, rebellions, and what he calls other holidays in hell in more than 40 countries. He's written 16 books on subjects as diverse as politics, cars, etiquette, and economics. PJ lives with his family in rural New England, which he says is about as far away from things he writes about as is possible. A longtime diehard Republican, PJ endorsed Hillary Clinton for president in 2016, declaring at the time that America was suffering from, quote, the most severe outbreak of mass psychosis since the Salem witch trials of 1692. One reviewer on Amazon.com wrote, he is an original thinker immersed in ancient texts. You can't Google his stuff as it is not there yet, which may be the highest compliment in this day and age. Now, so to give us his unique take on the election of Donald Trump and America in 2017, please welcome back to the Commonwealth Club, the ungoogleable PJ O'Rourke.
Thank you. Yeah, it's been a great year for political reporters, which means it's been a bad year for you. That's kind of the whole truth of the news business, you know. Is if it bleeds, it leads. Woman goes to church is not a viable headline. So, you know. So back in 2015, when this god awful election cycle began, I looked at all the candidates who wanted to be president, and I set out to answer this question. Who were these jacklegs, highbinders, wire pullers, mountebanks, swellheads, bunkum spigots, boodle artists, four flushers, and animated spittoons offering themselves as worthy of America's highest office? I mean, did they take us voters for fools? Well, yes, of course. You know, they always do. But were they also deluded? Were they also insane? Were they receiving radio broadcasts on their teeth fillings telling them that they should be president, you know? So we muddled along, and finally in America's political primary and caucus voters, they narrowed the field of fools down to 5. Cruz, Clinton, Kasich, Sanders, and Trump. Now, that's not a list of presidential candidates. That's the worst law firm in the world. You know? That's a law firm that couldn't get Caitlyn Jenner off on a charge of Bruce Jenner identity theft. I mean, has the office of the presidency diminished in stature until it attracts only the leprechauns of public life? Or have our politicians shrunk until none of them can pass the carnival test? You must be taller than the clown to run for president, you know? You know, in the beginning, it seemed as if the two candidates would just inevitably be Jeb Bush and Hillary Clinton. That's what everybody predicted, and me too. And I trembled for my country, because members of the electorate would go into the voting booth and they would see the names Bush and Clinton, and they would think to themselves, gosh, I'm getting forgetful. I did this already, you know? And they'd leave without marking the ballot, you know? Voter turnout would be 6%. I mean, you know, the shuttle from the local retirement community would bring a few senile Republicans to the polls. A Democratic National Committee bus would collect some derelicts from Skid Row. And we would have the first president of the United States elected by a franchise limited to sufferers from memory loss and drunken bums. Actually sounds pretty good now. Should have gone for it. What happened to Jeb? I mean, he had it all. Jeb's young for a Republican, a Phi Beta Kappa, successful businessman, and a former governor of California, Florida. Former governor of Florida, where balloting incompetence and corruption are vital to the GOP. You know? Plus, he was rolling like a dirty dog in campaign contributions, and then, woof, it all just went away. And it turned out that even Hillary Clinton, you know, after years of having the nomination locked down, she didn't. She didn't have it locked down. She faced a serious challenge from the commander of the Vermont Kong, Bernie Sanders. You know, now Bernie just came right out and said he was a socialist. You know, now that may be fine in some parts of the world where they're used to socialists, such as here, maybe. But, you know, out there in red state America, you say you're a socialist, and what people hear is, that guy's going to grab my flat screen TV and give it to a family of pill addicts in the backwoods of Vermont. You know? Bernie said he wanted to make America more like Europe, and I'm thinking, great idea, you know, because Europe's had such a swell track record for like more than 100 years now, you know, ever since Archduke Ferdinand's car got a flat in Sarajevo in 1914. Just been terrific. Make America more like Europe. Where do you even go to get all the Nazis and commies and 90 million dead people that it would take to make America more like Europe? And yet, you could see, you know, what Bernie's appeal was compared to Hillary. I mean, Hillary carried more baggage than the Boeing she used as Secretary of State, visiting every country that later blew up in her face in her quest to fulfill the mission of the U.S. Secretary of State, which is to accumulate frequent flyer miles. She had Julian Assange set up her State Department email server. She put the Dalai Lama on security duty at the U.S. consulate in Benghazi. Geopolitical conflicts of interest at the Clinton Foundation, they were so large they had to be weighed on Chris Christie's bathroom scale, you know? And then at any moment, that ferret of her husband, you know, might slip his leash and get up to, you know, old tricks, running up intern pant legs, you know? And so that left us with Donald Trump, the abominable showman, landlord of the flies. Big mouth, bigot, liar, lech, a dog, a rat, a mouse, a cat to Twitter a nation to death. A braggart, a rogue, a villain that fights by the book of Steve Bannon. A plague on all your hotels, resorts, and condominiums, Donald Trump, you know? How could a person like Donald Trump possibly become president? I mean, maybe it's just a matter of what the great political satirist H.L. Mencken said. Mencken said, democracy is the theory that the common people know what they want and deserve to get it good and hard. Or, more likely, it's part of something larger. Because here in the United States, we're not alone in having a political awkward moment. You know, I mean, we seem to be in the midst of a global revolt against the political elites. The political elites who created the post-World War II international order and who, for the past 70 years, have been running everything into the ground as far as a lot of ordinary voters are concerned. I mean, internationally, we're seeing a rise in xenophobia and jingoism and authoritarianism, And it ranges from the faintly comic spectacle of the European Union in shambles to the deeply sinister activities of Vladimir Putin and Xi Jinping. I mean, taking measurements for a new Iron Curtain, you know? Now you would think, you'd think that this would seem worse to ordinary voters than a mere standard-issue political elitism of a Jeb Bush or Hillary Clinton. But the political elites did, create their own problem. I mean, over the past four generations, the hallmark of the political elites has been the expansion of political power. Political power has expanded in size and expense. I mean, one-third of the world's GDP is now spent by the politicians in governments around the world. One out of every three things you make is grabbed by governments. I mean, if your cat has three kittens, one of them is a government agent. Political power has expanded in scope. Politics casts its net over every little aspect of life. I mean, nothing is so private that it isn't tangled up in politics. I mean, transgender bathrooms. We knew that politics is crap. Now we find out that where we take one is a political issue, you know? You know, and I have to say to the political elites, when are you guys going to realize, guys and gals, going to realize that politics is just, it's a two-way street? You know, the elite politicians have spent, you know, four generations creating a powerful, huge, heavy, unstoppable monster truck of a government. And then those same elite politicians get all shocked and weepy when a horrible politician, whom they detest, gets behind the wheel, turns the truck around, and runs them over, you know? We need to make the truck smaller. Make the truck smaller. Yank the engine, install foot pedals, you know? Make the government into a kitty car so that the worst that can happen is it bangs us in the shins, you know? And so people all over the world are saying, you know, we're sick of the elites. We're tired of the experts. To hell with the deep thinkers who think they know what we should have better than we do, and who, while they're at it, are grabbing everything we've got. And we see this, this revolt against the elites, for example, in the Brexit vote. We see it in the rise of alternative political parties in Europe. On both ends of the political spectrum, both Greens on the left and nationalists on the right. We can see it in Brazil, where almost every politician in the country, left, right, or middle of the road, has been charged with corruption for the simple reason that they're guilty of it. Now, in the case of Brexit, Britain's political elite, its business elite, and its trade union elite, they were all opposed to Brexit. And that's to say that the people who supported the Iraq War, plus the people who caused the 2008 global financial crisis, plus the people who nationalized the British automobile industry, they were all in unprecedented agreement on one issue, and the voters just felt they couldn't go wrong voting against this trifecta, you know? It was Latin America. There was a very similar case in Colombia. Colombia's elites spent 5 years negotiating a peace treaty with a starving rabble of communist guerrillas who had been marauding in the country's hinterlands since 1964. And a plebiscite was held to ratify that peace agreement, causing Colombia's voters to ask, what? What? After 52 years of murder, kidnapping, pillage, theft, and trafficking in narcotics, the guerrillas are getting retirement benefits, you know? Plebiscite failed, you know? Even the dull politics of Australia have been in turmoil. I mean, the politics in Australia are so dull that the name of the Conservative Party is the Liberal Party. But Australia has had five prime ministers in 6 years, and its last election nearly resulted in a hung parliament. Hung parliament, you know, must have been tempting. I suppose it's hanging legislators is immoral and probably illegal too, except in Queensland if the parliamentarians are caught chasing sheep. Politics of Canada, even duller than the politics of Australia. And yet in Canada they have a premier who's a completely inexperienced, dashing young celebrity named Justin. Now I haven't Googled Canadian politics, because who would? But I'm assuming that Justin is Bieber. So, and of course, here in America, obviously, we saw the revolt against the elites and the ridiculous rise of Donald Trump. And I'm thinking, okay, I understand the desire to shake things up, but why Trump, of all people? Well, Trump may be a rich guy. Maybe he's a member of the 1%, like he says he is. But, you know, there's nothing elite about him, for sure. Nothing elite about the way he sounds. Sounds like the rest of us, except he sounds like the rest of us after we've had six drinks, you know. He doesn't even drink, you know. He's a jerk. A guy's a jerk. But, you know, you can imagine playing a round of golf with him. You know, cheats, but so do I. Now imagine a round of golf with Hillary Clinton, okay? He's got 20 Harvard graduate caddies who've read all the books about golf but have never been on the links, you know? And they spend the whole match telling you, not her, but you, what club to use. And the Secret Service is there to make sure that you take Hillary's advisor's suggestion that you hit from the fairway with a sand wedge, you know? And after your chip shot, the cup and the pin somehow get moved closer to Hillary's lie, in an appropriate term to use in any game that Hillary is playing. And the scorecard mysteriously winds up on Hillary's personal email server, you know? So, you know. Of course, on the other hand, I don't know, you know, if I could stand how long I'd last playing a round of golf with Donald Trump, you know, before I gave in to the temptation to whack a Titleist into the back of his skull while he's standing on the green, nudging his ball with his foot and to create an alternative fact about how close it is to the hole. But anyway, global revolt against the elites, you know. In many ways, it's a little puzzling. I didn't really feel the power of this myself while I was reporting on this. And in certain ways, the beginning of the 21st century, it seems like an odd time to be having some sort of revolt against the elites, and especially in a country like ours where things are going at least fairly well, you know. I mean, we're not in desperate financial straits. Now, the Great Recession of 2008, that was painful, and there was a certain amount of waking up on friends' couches after somebody took the house, you know. But, you know, these days, practically everybody in America has had a divorce, so we'd been through that before, you know. This was something we couldn't survive. And if there were any bread lines during the Great Recession, they sure weren't handing out loaves of love-the-taste, low-carb, thin-slim, you know. I mean, America's obesity crisis abides. We are embroiled in a long war. More than 7,000 American combatants have died during the 15 years of the War on Terror. But more than 7,800 American combatants died at the Battle of Gettysburg. You know, streets are not filled with protesters against the war we're in now. I mean, hippies aren't sticking daisies in drones. You know, we are culturally and politically polarized in America these days, but it's not in a way that would startle an old school history professor and jolt him awake from his nap in the faculty lounge, you know. The year 1861, I mean, that was polarized, you know. Fort Sumter isn't taking any incoming at the moment, as far as I know. And yet, the American people are fearful, and they blame their fears on the political elite. And one of the reasons for this, important reason, is because the political elite have done a lousy job dealing with certain problems. The Middle East, for example, I mean, demons have been unleashed in the Middle East. Elites failed to address the problems that caused the demons to be unleashed. Indeed, elites seem to have been breeding demons in the kennels of elite diplomacy, elite geopolitics, and elite military strategy. And then those elites turn these demons loose in the Middle East, as if demons had ever been an endangered species in the region, as if the elites were trying to reintroduce demons, you know? And one result has been murder all over the world. I mean, how much further away from the quarrels and the hatreds of the Middle East could a person get than to be at Latin night in a gay nightclub in Orlando, Florida? I mean, you know, another result, of course, of this mishandling of the Middle East is the refugee crisis in Europe. And the Europeans are going, well, what do the elites care? You know, the refugees aren't crowding the stairways and the corridors and jostling the elites in the halls of the European Parliament in Brussels. The refugees aren't building shanty towns on the tennis courts of the elites' private country clubs, you know. You know, to elites, immigration means nannies, it means household staff, means fun new ethnic restaurants, you know. Elites don't seem to be able to see any similarity between the wall that Donald Trump has promised us and the gated communities in which the elites live, you know? And another problem that the elites have caused for themselves is the elites have promised that politics can fix everything. Well, when you promise that you can fix everything, then everything that's broken is your fault, you know? I mean, if political elites say that politics can fix climate change, then I want to see Bill Clinton shoveling my driveway, you know? I mean, yeah, I know, he's got heart trouble, but thanks to global warming, my driveway only had a few inches of snow this winter. So what we're seeing in this global revolt against the elites is the elites ending up getting blamed for everything, whether or not it's their fault, including getting blamed for the fact that we live in a time of rapid change. And never mind that much of that change is good change. A number of people worldwide living in extreme poverty, living on less than a dollar a day, that has been reduced by half since the year 2000. It's an amazing, marvelous project. And yet, also, despite some recent backsliding, you know, there's been an overall growth in human liberty over the past 30 years, definitely since the 1989 fall of the Berlin Wall. And you know, to be fair to the elites, rapid change creates problems for them too. You know, speedy transformation in social mores, economic norms, and political givens, it confuses everybody. Confuses everybody, especially those who thought they were leading the mores, norms, and givens parade, you know? I mean, mankind no longer has to march in lockstep. People are becoming individual persons instead of masses on review. And this is great, but certain difficulties arise on the parade ground when the stride is broken. You know, when the band breaks up, it can leave the tuba to be turned into a beer bong. You know, the fellow with the bass drum sitting on the curb playing the solo from Inagata Da Vida, the trombonist using his slide to goose the cornet player, and nobody left who can spell Glockenspiel, you know? And meanwhile, the elite drum major is just some dork standing in the middle of the street wearing a goofy hat and waving a stick, you know? So, you know, swift improvements in transport, in communication, and in technical capabilities have combined to produce this thing we call globalization, international trade, shrinking the Earth to a Pluto-sized planet. Well, that's great sometimes. I mean, we love having everything from everywhere brought right to our door, except when we don't. You know, like we love going to Yellowstone Park, but how much do we love having the herds of bison, the geysers, the trees, the mountains, the tourists, and the bears all in our rec room? You know, I mean, we'll need to clean the carpet. And then we go to work in the morning and find out a bear ate our job, you know? World is a smaller place now. Did this make the political elites think that it would make that the smaller world would make everyone get along? I mean, try it with your kids, you know? Put them in a small place, such as the back seat of your car. Now take them to see the world, you know? Take them to, you know, for example, Yellowstone Park from, say, New Jersey, you know? I mean, how are your kids getting along? I guess political elites don't take family car trips. You know, I guess political elites don't even fly economy class. You know, then there is, of course, whatever it is that's going on with the internet, about which I would be the wrong person to ask. I finally got MySpace figured out, only to discover that the only person in MySpace is me. And incidentally, concerning the internet, whose bright idea was it to make sure that every idiot in the world is in communication with every other idiot? But I take it on trust that the digital revolution will change everything. And for all I know, it's done so already. You know, I mean, you know, didn't there used to be a bookstore next to the, hey, where'd Sears go? You know, I mean, so, yeah, I'm glad. Look, I'm glad I can comparison shop for a refrigerator online and buy any brand that exists and have it delivered the next day with free shipping. But, you know, the Kenmore repairman at Sears, like, he's now enlisted as a foot soldier in America's opioid addiction attack, you know, and how do I get my refrigerator into the UPS drop box when the ice maker quits working, you know? I mean, all change is disruptive. All change is scary. Changing a diaper, change of life, any change in a wart or mole. frightening people asking for spare change on the street, you know? Got a little of that here. You know, when contemporary social and economic change are combined with contemporary distrust of political elites, a distrust that in some cases has been earned, the results can be very disturbing. I mean, Russia's ugly new nationalism comes from Vladimir Putin harnessing popular outrage at the incompetent kleptomaniac political elites who took possession of Russia after perestroika. Xi Jinping's neo-Maoism makes use of the popular anger at this all the tea in China scale of corruption among Chinese elites. Indeed, there are anti-elite aspects to a fanatical interpretation of jihad. I mean, ISIS terrorists they hate elites so much that they have suicide squads of elites who go around killing themselves. You know, I mean, modern world is a scary world, and fear is a bad schoolmarm. And we have got a monster at the blackboard, and how can people in the democratic countries learn even the 1+1 fundamentals of democracy when all they can think of is, eek, teacher's huge and slimy and scaly and has tentacles growing out of its head, you know? So what happens is the pupils in that class, they turn for help to the big stupid bully at the back of the classroom, and that's Donald Trump. So that's all I know. if you have some, we have some questions.
Yeah.
I'll make up some other stuff.
All right.
Now, what do we do? Do we both sit down now?
Yeah,
or,
come
yeah
on, sit.
Why not? You know, I'm not getting any younger.
As if by the fire.
Yeah.
So our thanks to PJ O'Rourke, political satirist, and the author of the new book, How the Hell Did This Happen? The Election of 2016. It's now time for our question period, and we already have a number of questions, so let's begin. I have about 10 questions here, and half of them are about this.
Are about?
Impeachment.
Impeachment.
Do you think it will happen? When? Please tell us it will happen soon. I'm pretty sure that's kind of what you're saying. So, yeah, what do you think? What are the chances?
I don't know, but I know how you'll be able to tell. When Fox turns on Trump. You already see little sparkles of this. Shepard Smith, you know, not everybody's totally on board with this. You don't see it from Fox much, but you do see it from the Wall Street Journal. The Wall Street Journal has given Trump some timeouts, you know. And of course Trump is like such a mess, and so has so little impulse control, that it's perfectly conceivable that he will do or already has done something that's impeachable. But let us not forget Bill Clinton. You know, this impeachment thing is not as easy as it looks. You know, it was my wife, actually, at the moment of Bill. I was going like, you know, I don't think the Republicans are going to do well here with, like, trying to impeach somebody for sex. That's a throw the first stone, you know, you use. And my wife said, no, I mean, think about what this was really about. Think about the power aspect of this. This is an intern, what was she like, 19 or 20, I mean, barely out of her, you know, still in her adolescence, obviously somewhat fragile. And this is the most powerful man in the world. Don't think about the sex, she said, think about the disparity of power, how wrong that was. But of course, that isn't what he got impeached for. He got impeached for lying about it, you know, which is something that absolutely my first instinct about sex is to lie about it. Like, say things like, yeah, I still have it a lot. that's me. So you got to remember that that's a very difficult process, and it's certainly not going to happen until there's some change in the balance of power in Congress, which may well happen in the next congressional election.
Now, you wrote, populism is a libertarian tragedy. Since the beginning of democracy in 5th century BC Athens, the greatest danger to democratic institutions institutions has been the demos, the people themselves, the very item that constitutes democracy. Democracy doesn't just contain the seeds of its own destruction, it contains the roots, the fruits, and the whole damn tree. And then we have a question from the audience. This is, how much of an indictment of democracy is all of this? I'm all for an enlightened despot at this point.
No, we don't want that. Because once you get a despot, they're very hard to get rid of. And the first one may be enlightened, but the next 11 are going to be Caligula. So you don't want to go there. It's not an indictment of democracy per se. Democracy still is, as Churchill put it, the worst system anybody's ever come up with, except for all the other systems, for governing. But it is an indictment of a certain danger in democracy. And the danger in democracy is when individuals turn into a mob, which is what populism is about. And populism can come from either end of the political spectrum. I mean, famous 19th century example was William Jennings Bryan. He was an abolitionist. His racial views were not enlightened. And his economic views were perfectly insane. William Jennings Bryan said, "Oh, people don't have enough money. We'll just print more." That works, Weimar Republic will show you how well that works, But populism is the result of people getting into a mob mentality. There's almost always a scapegoat involved. With William Jennings Bryan, it was East Coast bankers, which you could also read as code for Jews, here it's immigrants, as if we were all full-blooded Sioux Indians, and come from all over everywhere. All the trends of populism. And one of the things I ask in my book is, I say, if you've gone around to individual Athenians and asked them one by one, if potty old Socrates with his goofy questions, and his sort of endearing eccentricities, had gone around and asked each Athenian personally, should I be put to death for asking silly questions and stuff? No, nobody. Nobody would have voted to put him to death. They had to get into a mob mentality first. They had to, they had this pure form of pure democracy that was particularly liable to the mob mentality. So they had to become a mob before they could condemn Socrates. Mobs are not good things.
How do we prevent them?
Well, how do you prevent them? Usually these kind of things arise in periods of extreme stress. I'm no liberal Democrat, so I'm not necessarily enthusiastic about all the stuff that Franklin D. Roosevelt did when he got elected and when the Democrats got a really solid majority, and eventually attained, not as quick as Roosevelt would have liked, but eventually attained a majority compliance anyway from the Supreme Court. I'm not crazy about all the stuff that he did, but given how bad the crisis was, and that economic crisis was quickly followed by a war, we could have wound up with a truly crazy leader at that time. And in fact, Philip Roth wrote a book about that, supposing that Lindbergh, then one of the most popular and pro-Nazi Americans around, what if he had become president? So we dodged a bullet on that. This one I found particularly surprising because I didn't really feel, I knew we were facing a lot of disgruntlement and a lot of frustration with government and so on. I didn't realize the feelings ran so deep as to make people go, "Hey, we've tried smart. Let's try something else." And indeed, I got to say, a lot of the Trump supporters that I talk to, now, this is partly because of where I live in rural New England. I didn't run into a bunch of xenophobes. I didn't run into a bunch of bigots. But I ran into a lot of people who were so frustrated with the scope of government regulation. A lot of small business people, a lot of skilled blue-collar craftspeople, a lot of people who did jobs like logging and so on. They were just so furious at government in general that they were, and you'd say to them, I like these people. I didn't, I don't think they were wrong. Like one guy said, Every time some genius down in Washington gets a bright idea, this phone book size plump of paper lands on my desk, you know, just that he used phone book size, you know, and tells, you know, what era, you know, he comes from. But he said, you know, I can afford Obamacare for my employees. My business is doing pretty well. But what I can't afford is that big paperwork dump on my desk. I don't have a legal department. I don't have an HR department. It's just me and my wife, and I'm a gearhead. You know, I know how to fill out all this stuff. And he said, you know, it's just everywhere. It's local regulations. It's state regulations. I like the guy, and he was funny about his complaints. You know, good natured about it. But I finally said to him, I said, look, you know, just between you and me, electing a maniac fixes this how. And he laughed. He said, I don't know, but I'm so sick of that. I'm sending him a message, you know. I think there was a lot of that out there. You know?
So you endorsed Hillary Clinton. You wrote, better a mangy cat than a rabid dog. You wrote, Hillary, I choose you. Goldman Sachs' milch cow over the Cretan bull, siring his herds of mini minotaurs, half men, half bullshit, laying waste to the country. Did you get any blowback on
that? Oh, yeah, yeah. My Republican friends and a certain father-in-law. Not exactly. Yeah, I got quite an earful from the father-in-law.
Stand by that?
I stand by it, absolutely. I voted for Hillary because I'm a conservative. You know, and what's at the root of conservatism is like the devil you know. Don't let go of the devil you know and grab the devil you don't know. I mean, you know. Look, status quo may not be great, but there's a lot of other quos out there, and some of them are really horrible. I mean, I felt with Hillary, I disagreed with her pretty much across the board, but I knew what I was getting, you know, and I was also getting an experienced person who had been through, you know, what would a mere nuclear missile attack be to Hillary after what she's been through with Bill. She'll keep her calm. Kim Dai Jung, whatever his name is, you know, his wife may be in trouble, you know, given Hillary's past behavior, but you know, and he'd be in big trouble. But anyway, no, I definitely voted for her. I'm going like, hey, Dorothy and Toto's house fell on her and I endorse her. You know, so the Munchkins endorse her because I don't want a flying monkey in the White House, you know.
Yeah. Well, you know, initially there was this wait and see. Everyone said, okay, just breathe. Everybody be cool. Maybe it'll be okay. Maybe he'll make some sort of pivot. Maybe we will get a, you know, Trump 2.0 to govern. How do you think he's doing?
Well, not very well, obviously, you know, but I mean, I do think that there's something. I think this sort of preemptive anti-Trump hysteria was a little bit of waste of breath and energy. I think that this is, you know, with dealing with somebody with as many sort of narcissistic personality, well, you know what he reminds me of most is raising toddlers. I'm sure many of you in this room have been through that. And I raised three toddlers. Well, my wife did, you know, but I stood around listening to the screaming, you know, and it's like, They love attention, you know, and if they can't get good attention, bad attention will do, you know. We've got three kids, we got three dogs. They're all like that, you know, and I mean, you know, I've got a bird dog that is absolutely completely devoted to me, completely loves me, but if I don't pay enough attention to her, good or bad, because when we're out in the field, I'm bossing her around, yelling at her to do this, do that, you know. But if I'm not paying any attention to her, she'll go right over to the good Oriental and piss, you know, right in front of everybody, you know, even if she just came in from outdoors, you know, so she, you know, and that's him, you know, so I thought, this is going to be a long fight, you know, let's save our energy, you know, we're going to have to fight it battle by battle by battle, you know, and I mean, so already, you know, there was a, I got a lot of objections to Obamacare. I do worry about its long-term financing and it being kind of an open-ended entitlement program, so on and so forth. But the Republicans had proposed a bill that who knows what was in there, you know? I mean, it was just, you know, other than some predictable Republican tax cuts for the rich, the bill was just a can of worms, you know? And it didn't happen. It didn't pass, you know? So these things have to be fought out one thing at a time and a sort of a general expression of exasperation, in some ways plays into the hands of the people who voted for Trump who are not in the basket of deplorables, but who are very frustrated. And sometimes, you know, they looked out at the immediate anti-Trump protests before he'd had a chance to do anything, and see, said, this is what bugs me. You know, this is, like that transgender joke I made, I actually stole that from one of the guys I was talking to at a Trump rally. He said, I'm a logger. It's the world's most regulated job. You can't imagine how many regulations we have to go through. You know, again, local, state, federal, EPA gets involved, OSHA gets involved. Everybody has got something to tell the loggers, he said. So I got all these political problems, all these political frustrations. And I go home, and I turn on the evening news, and what's the lead story? It's transgender bathrooms. He said, we're in the woods. We don't have any bathrooms, you know. Go over and use the any gender tree. And I'm, so that guy was not in the basket of deplorables. Not a bad guy. Politically naive, perhaps. Most of the Trump supporters I talked to really had not been involved in politics at all before. Didn't have any sort of notion that if you want some sort of systematic change from Washington, you have to have somebody who understands the system. You can't just, you know, it's like you wouldn't pick your heart surgeon because he was an outsider. Right, would you? Yeah. Because he was this guy standing on the street, you know, and he's coming in and going to do your open heart surgery with a spork, you know. it doesn't work that way. But this wasn't a bad person I was talking to, and he wasn't like blowing his top about where transgender people went to the bathroom. He's just going, of all the things that I got to worry about, this is just not one of them, you know. So.
We have a question from the audience. It says, in retrospect, at what point in the campaign should Republicans have stopped Trump? Or the media, or somebody, you know, should anyone have stopped Trump?
Well, that presupposes a kind of political organization that we really don't have in this country. I mean, in one of the chapters, I do a little rundown, this is caucus primary stuff. And so, our political parties, they may act otherwise, but they have no legal or constitutional standing in this country. They could be a biker gang. They could be a bowling league. You know, I mean, they have no standard, no legal standard. They are not part of the Constitution. They're not part of the government. They act like they are, but they're not. There's no law in there anywhere that says we have to have Republicans and Democrats and they have to sit on either side of an aisle or any of that stuff. And so what happens is there, as a result of their having no legal standing, there is no real centralized power in either party. You got a national organization, but that national organization is beholden to 51 state and District of Columbia local organizations, plus some more in our overseas territory, you know, because they get votes too. They get to vote on who they don't get to vote for. You go figure, but American Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico and Guam, you know, they all get to vote. And so that takes you to the state organizations. Now, those state organizations don't really exist either because they are beholden to the county chairman. And I don't forget, I've got it in the book, but they're like something like, you know, 2,000 counties in the United States. And those are the people that actually run the parties. And I said, you know, the chairman of the Republican Party is this guy in white shoes and white vinyl shoes and a white vinyl belt with the polyurethane bell-bottom pants on, you know, who's an ex-Dairy Queen franchisee. And the Democratic Party chairman is a woman who owns 40 cats, you know, and that's who's making these decisions, you know. So,
you write that you write about the Freedom Caucus. You say there were forces in the resurgent American conservatism that began their rise with the election of Ronald Reagan and then quit rising and started to droop into simplistic Tea Party obstructionism, as we've seen. Sort of the demise of the attempt to revise the health care bill. I mean, it goes beyond just Donald Trump, right? I mean,
yeah.
In terms of the elasticity of the party.
I don't think that Tea Party caucus was particularly, I don't think that bill was going to pass, even if the Tea Party caucus hadn't existed. But Tea Party caucus was like an earlier iteration of attempting to oversimplify politics. You know, I mean, you simply cannot govern a nation as big and diverse as the United States without politics being complicated. Tea Party people, again, I met them when they were sort of at their peak. Again, mostly very nice people, but they just said, look, we got this constitution, we got the rule book, let's play by the rules, you know? And, you know, so far as that went, that wasn't a bad sentiment, but politics is, of course, much more complicated than simply the basic rules or the laws of the country. It's a constant mix and match of coalitions, it's a set of Venn diagrams. Sometimes they overlap a lot. Sometimes the two circles in the Venn diagram don't touch at all. But it's always constantly coalition building. And how it was that the Republicans could spend 8 years damning Obamacare up and down and not have a replacement for it? How does that even work? You know, I mean, how could you? And the thing is, replacements were available. Every think tank in Washington, covering the whole political spectrum, from stern libertarian Cato Institute to Republican Heritage to sort of basic conservative AEI over to middle-of-the-road liberal Brookings Institute and every other one in between, all had an off-the-shelf healthcare Obama replacement. Every single one of those think tanks had studied Obamacare and could tell you what was good about it, what was bad about it, what was sustainable about it, what was unsustainable, because that was a pretty bad mishmash of a bill itself. Not as bad as the Republican one, but it contained a lot of compromises. And all you had to do was go around. I mean, the bunch of us in this room, as a committee of the whole, could have gone around to those think tanks, grabbed everything they had off the shelf, everyone, and we could sit down and in a couple of days we could probably put together a plan. Might not be fabulous, but it would be detailed, you know. And we would be able, which Republicans couldn't do, to go to the American public and say, look, this is what we have to do. And you know, Republicans never made any attempt to do this. They never made any attempt to get out in front of this thing and say, look, this is going to have some short-term downsides. I'm presuming there actually was a plan buried somewhere in that law, but which I don't know for sure. But say, look, here's going to be some short-term burdens and liabilities on this, but we have to have that in order to make it work in the long term. And here's what you can expect from the long term, and so on. And you know, we're trying to make sure that nobody's beggared by their health costs. And, that's always been my position. Even though I'm libertarian, conservative, don't want the government involved in the free market, even in the medical care free market, still, I don't want anybody in this country to be beggared by their medical bills. Absolutely not. We are too wealthy a country and too decent a country to have anybody beggared by their medical bills. Nobody should lose the house. The boat? Maybe the boat, but not the house.
Who's the most amusing Trump administration figure besides Trump himself?
Well, yeah, I don't know if any of them have risen to the level of amusing yet, you know, at least not intentionally, you know. I'm sort of amused by Steve Bannon, I got to say. I am kind of amused because, you know, Steve Bannon is nuts. But he actually has an ideology that if you were to accept the premises of it, is internally logical. You know, I mean, that is to say he has, like, and not that there aren't plenty to choose from out there, but like any good, bad ideology, it's internally consistent. You know, it's always the beauty of Marxism and why Marxism sucks in so many kids is it's internally consistent. You know, premises may be all wrong, but it's internally consistent. So here he is, the intellectual force behind the world's least intellectual administration. So there's Steve Bannon pushing on air. You know, I don't give him that much time, you know, because He's talking about all these like crazy books that he's read to a guy who's never read a book. Well, that's interesting. It was in a book, was it? But I'm sort of amused. I'm amused by his plight. I would be even more amused if he were. I shouldn't say if he was kicked out. I think he's probably one of the first to go.
Oh, you think so?
Oh yeah. Oh, just because, like I say, he's at variance with his boss, not about his core views, but because he has any core views. You know, I mean, it's just, you know, anything that smacks of intellect, even twisted intellect, is not going to go down well with this president. You know, I mean, that'd be like a medium rare burger for this guy, you know. Ooh, that got germs in it.
In Parliament of Whores, you said God is a Republican and Santa Claus is a Democrat. Who are the Republicans and Democrats now?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was a long time ago. I mean, I wrote that book, geez, a million years ago, and it was about how bad government is when government is working. Now it's like a whole new playing field. Well, everybody's Santa Claus now. You know, I mean, everybody's gotten on board with that. The last Republican, you know, who just, you know, the one thing you could at one time count on among a few Republicans, very few even then, but was that some of them would come out and say, is a famous line from Bill Buckley. People would give Bill Buckley like some sort of like liberal program to make nobody poor anymore and everybody, you know, healthy. And Bill would go, nice thought, you know. I mean, there used to be some there used to be a couple of people, Barry Goldwater, when he was, he said, that's a really nice idea. They can't afford that. No way in hell we can afford that. Tax people at 110%, we still wouldn't be able to afford that. There used to be some of those characters in the Republican, and it's like their whole purpose was to, like, you know, say, whoa, I mean, just stop it already. After all, it was Ike, not Adlai Stevenson, who made the military-industrial complex speech. You know,
I want to ask you, you've written about a number of people in this book who now sort of are in different roles. You wrote about Lindsey Graham. Lindsey Graham's strategy was to have a girl's name, tricking progressives into thinking they were voting for America's first transgender president.
Obviously, that didn't work.
You also said support for Lindsey Graham's presidential candidacy was limited to Lindsey Graham. And so I wanted to ask you, I mean, now he's sort of taken on a different role since the election.
He's much better.
As a big voice.
He's much better doing what he did, as many of these people were better. But, yeah, I mean, he's willing. You know, the guy that I really appreciate is John McCain. You know, I mean, the thing is, I've liked John for a while. I know John, and it's hard not to like John in person. But, you know, people used to say, John's so crazy. And then I went on a carrier embark. I flew out on a cod supply plane, and I caught the tail hook, you know, and I got rocketed back off after a few days. And I went out there, and I watched carrier pilots land on the carrier. And in heavy seas, I was out on the Theodore Roosevelt, the big stick, as they call it. And we were out a couple hundred miles off Virginia. And the seas were so high, I mean, the flight deck on a carrier is about 60 feet or something above the waterline. Spray was coming over the bow. That's how big the waves were. And they landed those planes, and they did it at night. And I thought, well, of course John McCain is crazy. Only a crazy person would do this. But, you know, so, yeah, we need more of those Republicans to start speaking up. You know.
You wrote Ben Carson. You wrote, he's a slightly dotty uncle who dresses in a monogrammed blazer, ascot, and velvet slippers to wash his car.
Now I'm sticking with that.
Now as the Secretary of HUD, you know, what's your expectation there?
Well, it's not department I would like to see rolled into another department anyway, and he might be just the guy to roll it into, you know. I've long thought that this idea of, like, this dates back to Gee, I know, probably Lyndon Johnson, but I remember Jimmy Carter doing it with the Department of Education. Like, we need to really pay attention to this issue in America. Education is really, really important. So we're going to create a department of it. Okay. And that's it. We create the department. So when you say later to President Carter, but President Carter, education is a really important, he says, yeah, we've got a whole department for that. You go over there and talk to them, you know. You needed a car, so you build a garage. That's the government approach. And then once you've got all these secretaries, isn't the room starting to get full, and you're the secretary of what? you want the president to have a coherent cabinet, well-developed sort of lines of management. And, once it starts to get to be a room like this size, and way over there is HUD, the guy way in the back.
You write a lot in the book about, or not a lot, but you write somewhat about the process, about the election process. You give some advice about how to perfect and improve America's election process. And we have a question from the audience. It says, why is it that it takes 2 years and so much money to vote on a president? And 12 hours before the election, 20% of the population says they require more information.
So part of
let's follow the Brits and have 6 weeks and vote.
Yeah. So part of it is the explanation I gave before of the disorganization in the two principal parties. But so in the book, I put in a couple suggestions of my own. One is that we get all the people who want to be president in one place, preferably a place that serves beer, and we decide which one we'd like to go on a road trip with, and that's
index.
Our president, which would have made Biden president, I'm almost certain, he's a jolly guy. I may not agree with him about a lot of stuff, but I'd certainly rather spend time in his company than the other people who were running. And then the other thing is I did this, actually, this one was researched. I went back through all the first ladies, not necessarily the wives of the presidents, but the people who, were sort of controlled the social agenda. Their partners or helpmeets. There were some nieces in there and so on. And that's a much better crop of people if we just elect the president and let the first lady run the country. It works. I mean, by the time we get to Thomas Jefferson, whose wife was dead before he was elected president, we got Sally Hemings. We have the first black woman chief executive, and she gets the Civil War over with before modern weaponry had been invented, much lower cost in life, Everybody gets to get past all that much earlier, when you get to Mary Todd Lincoln, you go, well, she's kind of a flake, but we didn't need Abe, because we'd already had Sally. So, it works out. It works out. Martha Washington's a lot richer. She could have bribed the British to get out of here, John Adams? Abigail. Yeah. Much smarter than John. Never would have passed the Alien and Sedition Act. And on it goes, pretty much. Even like Mrs. Harding was a much smarter person. Mrs. Hoover spoke fluent Chinese. And on it goes.
You wrote about Marco Rubio. You said Marco Rubio doesn't look old enough to drive. He steered his campaign like a sixth grader who could either see over the dashboard or reach the pedals, but not both at the same time. Now,
got one at home.
He's also become somewhat outspoken against the Trump administration.
I actually liked Marco Rubio. I saw Marco Rubio. One of the nice things about living in New England is you get to see the candidates at these little town hall meetings, and you get more of a sense of them, I think. And Rubio was very impressive at his town meeting. He was he had a pretty straightforward, very conservative, but straightforward, comprehensible platform. He was very honest with the voters about what he felt government could and couldn't do. He had some hostile questions that he handled with a great deal of grace and tact and patience, too. He was very patient with somebody had a angry Veterans Affairs question, you know, which, you know, it wasn't Marco's fault, but, you know, he handled it very well. And then the next day, at the same place, at St. Anselm's College in Manchester, New Hampshire, he got the needle stuck on the record. And I am watching that, and my heart is just sinking. Because anybody who does that kind of stuff like giving campaign speeches, in my case, promoting this book, you know, traveling around the country, doing radio interviews, some TV interviews and stuff, gets to that moment where you go, did I say that in the last interview, or did I just say that? And Marco Rubio was having an awful moment of, you know, of did I just say that? You just couldn't get out of the groove, and I thought, oh, that's it for you, you know. But he's young. He could, you know, he could come back. He seems, you know, approachable. I don't know.
Have you had any of that tonight?
Have I had any?
Any of that tonight? Any of that feeling like, uh-oh, did I already tell that story? Did you have any of that feeling tonight?
Oh, tonight?
Being
no.
In the loop? Okay,
no,
good.
No.
Yeah, we're
no.
keeping it. We're keeping
not
it real.
So far,
no. All right. So I got two related questions. One says the question shouldn't be how the hell do we get here. The question should be how the hell do we get out of this.
Yeah, well, that's where the beauty of being a reporter comes in. See, it's my job to go into the darkened kitchen, flip on the light switch, and watch the roaches scurry. Somebody else's job to step on them. No, honestly, if I knew how to get out of this thing, I would be the first to tell you. And but you know, one thing about America, and here I am having a slight moment of did I just say this? But keel, our country has a lot of keel. It can be pitched, it can be yawed, it can tilt one direction and tilt the other direction. It has a way of righting itself. Now, we don't want to depend on, you know, that doesn't mean we don't want to work to make sure that it, you know, that doesn't mean we can stop bailing. We have to keep bailing, you know. But the boat does have a lot of keel, and we do tend to get back to a sort of Americanism that's recognizable. Not perfect, of course, always lots, you know, to be done, you know, we do. Common sense does return to American political life, usually. We hope. Yes.
I have a question here. Aren't elites just another word for expertise?
Well, that's it. You know, when people get angry at elites, they just as I said earlier about, you know, you don't want an outsider as a heart surgeon, you know. They are. I mean, they do start to abandon judgment on expertise. And I think it was a particularly tough time for people who wanted expertise. This election was particularly tough on them because, you know, Donald Trump had the whole I'm a crazy wild man thing, you know, more fun than a barrel of monkeys thing's gone. And Bernie Sanders, you know, while you can admire the guy's honesty, his consistency, how long he's held on to these, you know, this core of beliefs that he have. It was like not happening stuff, you know. You're like talking about not happening stuff, you know. This is on what planet, Bernie, is this stuff going to happen? You know, this is just, you know, it just isn't going to happen. So, you know, you felt a lack of expertise at both of these ends. Then there was somebody who had actual expertise, Hillary Clinton, and could make you wish she didn't. You know, because she just, you know, she had that drone going, and she just had the magnificent grasp of detail and nothing else. You know, it just went on and on and on. Now her husband could do that too. Her husband could get stuck in that rut of dealing with excessive detail, but he had a kind of charm and warmth about him as a politician. Now, mind you, personally, I would trust her a lot farther than I would trust him. But I'm talking about his affect to the public. He had the sort of charm and warmth. He really did have that thing where I'm looking straight into your eyes and only you are in the room, you know. And I interviewed him when he was running for president the first time and when he was governor of Arkansas. And it was a great interview. It was me, Bill Greider, the kind of lefty then writer for Rolling Stone, and Hunter Thompson. So,
who was more fun?
Actually, none of us were much fun. And because it didn't work that way. You didn't really interview Bill, you listened to Bill. I mean, you'd bring something up and then off he went. And he had this trick. He would go around the table and he would focus on each of us as though we were the only person in the room and the only person in the world, you know, and he would explain whatever he was explaining, and then it would be the next person's turn. Well, two things happened. One was that he started going on about microcredit. This is how we're going to solve poverty in our inner cities is microcredit. I'm going, Governor, we got in our inner cities these $100,000 drug deals are going down. Do you think lack of capital is the main problem? I'm not so sure. But anyway, I just let him go on about this. And he says, Grameen Bank, you know, and Bangladesh has done such. And again, I'm going, Bangladesh, United States. I think kind of different set of problems. But he's gone, you know, Muhammad Yunus, the Grameen Bank, microcredit out to the villages. And I said, you know, that's very interesting, Governor, because I just got back from Bangladesh. Mm-hmm. I toured the Grameen Bank, and I toured the villages, and I sat down for most of the day with the number two guy, not with Muhammad Yunus. And he changed the subject so fast. It was right on to Hunter, you know, lock on the eyes, you know, the Vulcan mind meld with Hunter Thompson. But he had not paying any attention to what his subject matter was, except that he knew, oh, shit, here's some guy that actually knows something about microcredit. Not that I knew a lot, but, you know, I mean, but, you know, more than him. He turns to Hunter and he goes, we're going to put 40,000 new police officers on the streets. And I was up all night with Hunter trying to explain to Hunter that that was not a personal threat. It was just his turn to be talked to, and that was the new subject matter. But
you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California program, and our guest is noted political satirist PJ O'Rourke. I'm Melissa Kane. You can hear Commonwealth Club programs on the radio and catch up with program videos on the club's YouTube channel and find us on Facebook and Twitter. And we've reached the point in our program where there is time for one last question, and I have it right here, and it's two words. What next?
What next? What next indeed? Well, I think what happened, this is what I hope happens. Washington is a big amoeba, and I'm hoping that it will surround Trump and his little coterie and dissolve and digest them. You know? And we will be back to our... What I expect will happen will look a lot more like the flip side of the coin of the past 8 years. You're going to be stymied in various ways. You know, at first it will be some of the Tea Party Republicans and some of the liberal Republicans that are going to cause, just Trump's margins is nothing like the kind of majority that FDR had in Congress. And it's a very narrow balancing point in the Senate, and as we just found out, not such a big majority in the House. So I think we'll sputter along with him maybe getting one or two. He might accomplish one or two things. You know, it would be nice to think that somebody would do something about tax reform just from a, you know, our tax code is 5 times the length of the Bible. Now, come on. It's like, I like to think of myself as a reasonably religious guy, but even I flake off when it gets to apocalypse. You know, it can't possibly need that much stuff. But you know, I don't give him much hope of making it. And if he does make, you know, I mean, Reagan did the right thing. It was the tax code needed simplification back then. And he managed to get a deal going with Tip O'Neill where they made it revenue neutral. You know, that whatever you fixed up in the, it can't possibly need to be as complex as it currently is. So, but I don't see that happening. I think we just muddle along, and the Congress changes in a year and a half, and then we're back to stalemate. But hey, you know, there's worse things than stalemate. There's like actively bad stuff, you know. There are worse things than having Washington incapacitated.
When they're not.
Yeah. Yes, when they're not.
Alrighty, our thanks to PJ O'Rourke, celebrated political satirist.
Thank you.
He's the author of the new book, How the Hell Did This Happen? The Election of 2016. We also thank our audiences here on the radio, television, and the internet. We wish to remind everyone here that copies of PJ's book are for sale, and he'll be pleased to sign them in the fireside room following the program. We appreciate you letting him make his way to the signing table as quickly as possible. I'm Melissa Kane of CBS 5 Television, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned.
Thank you.